Hi, my name's Steve, and this is a course on using Python to work with open source AI. I created this course because there's more to using AI than just grabbing a big company's model and wrapping their SDK. In this course, we'll use Python with Hugging Face to pull down open source models and learn that there's more to AI than just prompts and text generation. We'll learn how to take unstructured data and turn it into structured formats that we can use in our day-to-day programming. We'll learn how to generate images using Stable Diffusion. We'll use Google Colab to explore and share our code and get access to powerful GPUs in the click of a mouse. Go beyond the big company models and learn what open source can do to solve the next problem in your code base.
So there's a bunch of decoding strategies. We've got the like greedy decoding strategy, just pick the single most likely nest token. It's fast and predictable, but we will get mostly the same thing every time. The other thing we can do is start to play with that temperature, right? Let's actually run all of these and just see some stuff in here. We'll let all that go for a second. So like here, I'm having it run multiple times. We kind of saw this at the beginning. This is like a temperature of roughly, at this point, zero. It's just using that kind of greedy immediate next one. I have a max token limit of 20, and so it did stop at one point. If we bump that up to maybe 22, given this particular answer. Give that a second. We will likely see two of the exact same sentences when it comes out. Right. And so there is no guessing at this point. It literally will begin to like, you will always get the same thing every time because it is picking the most likely next word. Now, you can have some questions on why those are the next likely next words. I cannot answer that one for you. But statistically speaking, that according to GPT-2, did anyone look up when GPT-2 dropped? It might have been like happier times. You know, like you will get effectively the same output. And then, so then we have that temperature. We accidentally saw this a little bit earlier as well when we played around with it, where we will get slightly different ones. But this graphs it out for you. For all of the words, like what was my initial beginning one? What did I write here? A lot of that's the graphing stuff. I think it's the, oh yeah, see, artificial intelligence is. So a lot of this code, if you're like, what is all of this? It's drawing the pretty graphs. Don't worry about the code. It's just drawing the pretty graphs. So you can see like, for each temperature level, like what it thinks the next, like what its choices of the next word should be. At a very low temperature, it doesn't have a lot of options. Right, and a lot of creativity there. As the temperature goes up, the amount of words it's willing to consider and sample about to be the next word, right, goes up. And so that's where that creativity comes from versus always getting the same thing. The lower you turn that knob, the like almost like turns the overall volume down. So you've got to be like really loud to get through. And as you turn the temperature up, you can get more noise, right? And so the higher the temperature, the more words are statistically available for it to pick, which will either get you more creative answers or complete garbage, right? And that's why it's a dial, right? That you can kind of set as well. You know, by default, you usually see like, 0.5. And so if we did it with at 0.7, you get something a little bit better than when we saw originally at the lowest setting. The future of artificial intelligence is a wider, more complicated topic. What kind of services and capabilities will be needed to support the growing demands of AI in many areas of everyday life? Yeah, GPT-2. So it still reads like like those tests that you took in like third grade, the reading comprehension standardized test. Like it's not a necessarily interesting read, but you can kind of see with the graphing like how its choices of the next word tends to come up. And then we have that like top K and top P nucleus name. And again, I will remind you that these are all notebooks where you can go in here. You want to change that to a different number. You want to turn on the top K. You can go ahead and try out all of these things and you can kind of see how the differences will show back up. The fun part is you never really know what you're going to get with these things. The future of artificial intelligence is like a trap. its greatest threat isn't foreseeable. It's between you and it, says John Goodman. I think John Goodman, the actor, has an H in his name, though. This might be a, like, it's not totally wrong on that one. But, like, one of the things that jumps out at me that would be interesting to do is you then take that output and then throw it in that, like, named entity recognition and figure out, like, what comes out. Like, always the combination of things becomes the most interesting. If you were to get the tiniest, like, open source model today, you would, like, 7 billion? That's a weak model, right? Like, yeah, like the tiny ones, like when we, I'll show you LM Studio a little bit, you can see the big LLMs on Hugging Face that you can download and easily run on your MacBook today are in the billions of parameters. This one is 355 million parameters. So, but like also, does anyone want to watch me do this for 6 hours? And we're only going to train a subset of those, right? With our extra data. Right, and so we've got this library from Hugging Face where we can pull in this parameter efficient fine tuning with that model and this configuration, right? Right, like the task type is that causal LM that we saw before, some other little settings that we can talk about if we're interested. And so then we tokenize basically each example, we pad it to whatever the maximum length is of that tokenizer. So we want them all to be the same length. So this is gonna be like, whatever the quote is, I don't care how long the quote is. The quote is how long the quote is, and then pad it with that extra space, right? So they're all equal, right? And so we'll put that in place. And this is what like our first, like this is what the first record is gonna end up looking like. So we can see that this is our like blank tokens at this point, right? So all the stuff we saw before. So this quote from Oscar Wilde is gonna be quote by Oscar Wilde, colon, space, open quote, the quote, close quote, end of statement, right? And so you can see the tokens, it breaks it up into the various tokens. It's like, cool, it was this long. We don't actually care about the rest of them. They're all these BS tokens, which are slightly different for each one. If we chose a different model, a different tokenizer, the I don't care token is probably different. This is the padding token in this case. And so that is effectively what that is the number version of this string, because this is the text that we made really when we mapped everything. And then we just say basically like, here's all the fancy numbers. I'm going to feed them into you and you're going to go for it, right? And so the trainer API has a training loop where we evaluate it, we log it, we like do some checkpoints along the way. And these are all the arguments we're going to take. We're going to write it to a file called GPT2 medium quotes. We're going to do one full pass through the data. You can do more full passes if you want. Obviously, doing more full passes with a law of diminishing returns is good, but then we got to wait for that, and I don't want to. So we trained this, and again, like I think it took like 5 or 10 minutes on when I did on the free one, but for our own sanity, I bumped up to a bigger one. It took 2 minutes, and like if it is truly like you are trying to train a model to get like stuff in a different format or style, whatever, honestly, 3 hours would be fine. Half an hour would be fine, right? Like whatever. But for the purpose of all of us in a room today, I went with a relatively small model with a relatively small data set on a relatively fast GPU. But I did this on that T4 and it's, yeah, go make yourself a cup of coffee or something. It'll be done and not too bad. So what I'm going to do is I've got the base model where we're going to have a pipeline base generator and we're going to say text generation. We're going to give it GPT2 medium and the tokenizer. Which I probably could have left out, but I didn't. And we'll look at the result for one sequence, and we'll look at the response, and then we'll go to our fine-tune model, where I pass it in directly here with a few more stuff, low CPU memory usage again. You can play around with some of this. You'll obviously get better results if you don't do all of the please don't blow through the free tier that I did, but also I did that for you. So, whatever. And so that's a pre-generated one. That's not like, that's from last time I ran that. That's not for my newest, latest, and greatest fine-tuned one. So let's rerun that. And yeah, so we'll see the difference where that's the original one where, okay, it starts with, you know, again, I wrote quote by Bob Dylan was my initial prompt. So it's picking up from there. So quote by Bob Dylan comes from me. Everything after that comes from the model. Where you can see like, okay, it doesn't know the colon. I mean, it plausibly seems like a quote, but it's not keeping that format. And it's kind of like rambly and going on. And probably until it hits the max tokens, if it ever hits the max tokens. And then like, I don't even know what it's talking about. Right? Versus the one that came in my fine-tune model, where like, if you think about that, the string that I formatted, that first Oscar Wilde quote that we saw, where it's like, quote by Oscar Wilde, colon, open parentheses, like a reasonable size quote, end your conversation. Right? That end, like, even like before, I think some of the stuff we were doing before wasn't like, there weren't a lot of those end of, you know, end of sentence, end of whatever, end of segment tokens. So even when I've said, hey, listen for the end of segment token and stop talking, GPT was still rambling. But now it has been pretty well trained. Just, you know, all those quotes are pretty short because they're just like quotes that you would see like on an inspirational poster. And then they all have that end of sequence token, right? Which causes it to stop. And so you can see that like 2 minutes of training, right? On 2,500 lines of an open source data set radically changed how that relatively small model behaved. So text image is interesting, but we've all seen it before. What about image to image, right? And so this involves taking two pipelines, right? Involves taking a text to image pipeline in our case, and then you can actually use an image as the baseline to then further like adjust the image as well. So we're gonna grab two pipelines this time. We're gonna have the text to image pipeline that we had before. So that's gonna be Stable Diffusion pipeline. Makes sense. The model ID, we're gonna use the same model for both. So on and so forth. Again, the safe tensors are just ones that make sure they can't execute arbitrary code. So they are tensors that are safe. That's like, everyone likes it when you explain a term using the words in the term. And then we've got this image-to-image pipeline, which is, yeah, just using, again, a different set of abstractions. Like, same model, right? It's just the, like, extra, like, the tokenizing, the inputs, all that kind of stuff. Hugging Face is just wrapping it up for you. You could do all this stuff by hand. You could also make your own HTTP server and roll your own crypto, too. You know, like, do whatever you want. And then, so then I have, and you can see the code for this, you can see the code, it's two strings. I did break that out pretty well, where we can change. So I've got a sketch of a house, like a literal sketch, a simple sketch of a house, and then a futuristic glass house with neon lights, cyberpunk style. I think I was looking at those Mudang pictures too much, and that's how I ended up there. And so then we'll go ahead and we'll use the text to image pipeline, and I will run that. I gotta put those strings into memory. So let's do that as soon as it's done loading these models. And then we're gonna create that base image. So we're gonna start with just what we saw in the previous section, where we're gonna take some text, we're gonna make an image intentionally. I'm gonna start the next one while I'm at it. Intentionally, I chose a sketch. It should look like a little pencil drawing. If it's really like, if live coding wasn't scary enough, live, random, will the AI do what you want is a new level of fear that I've engaged in this week. And so it will theoretically give me a sketch. And then what I'm doing is I'm going to show you at strengths 0.3, 0.5, and 0.7. I think it varies. And you can change any of these numbers, like I keep telling you. At one point, I was 0.8. I think I made my point at 0.7. That's where I left it. Okay, that's our sketch of a house. Neat. And I will say, when you play with this, play with these prompts. Did I make it a haunted house at some point? Of course I did, Right. Did I make it like Princess Bubblegum's castle from Adventure Time? Yes. Right. Do all of those things. It is part of the great joy that I have not felt since I first started learning how to program and I put something in a database and took it back out again. And that no longer fills me with joy. And this does. So you should experience that joy too. Like the first time I did like Ajax and changed something in the DOM and I felt like a wizard. I didn't feel like a wizard anymore until now. All right, so we got our house. All right, so effectively the loop here is basically because I'm going through the three strengths. The important part here is we've got that image-to-image pipeline where we're passing in the base image, our transformation prompt, and then some stuff that I'm doing to put it on a pretty graph for you. So don't worry about that. That's not important. But you can see that's the original. 0.3, I guess, right? There are some changes. 0.5, we're getting a little futuristic cyberpunk. And then 0.7, we're there. I can see that it came from the image, but I'm starting to lose the thread a little bit. You know what I mean?
There's a big difference between those last two.
Yeah, and let's play a fun game. I don't know with the code that I was flexible enough to take more than three, so what we're going to do is 0.3 was a waste of our time. Let's do six. Let's see the difference between six, five, six, and let's, do we want to do eight or nine?
Nine.
Nine, all right. I think six was the sweet spot, I got to say. Six is definitely the sweet spot. Nine looks cool, but again, if you think about it, the way that this works, took the original image, added back noise, and denoised it again. So nine is obviously adding back, like, the closer you get to one, the more you added noise back and, like, noised over the original. So it makes sense. But yeah, I think even compared to, like, seven, I mean, five, you could argue that if we're truly taking the nature of the assignment, which is take the original image. It's that cyberpunk thing that I think makes it a little like nuanced here. I would argue that five understood the assignment the best. I kind of like six though too.